In this video, we will be explaining the pivoting function and showing how to create a pivot table in KNIME Analytics Platform. Let's first take a look at some cases where pivoting is helpful. Here, we have a dataset that contains daily weather information from different cities over the course of 1 year. In the pivot table, each cell quantifies the total sum of sunshine hours for each city, here in the column headers, in each month, here in the row IDs. In the second example, we have a dataset containing sales information, country, purchase order date, and purchase order value. In the pivot table, each cell quantifies the average purchase order value for each country in each month. Our third example concerns customer data. We want to know the number of customers according to different age and gender groups. In the pivot table, we want to report the age bins in the rows and the genders in the columns. So each data cell contains the number of customers in a particular group of age and gender. Using the pivoting node in KNIME Analytics Platform, it is easy to make this kind of summary. As we show here, the different values of one column become row IDs, and the different values of another column become column headers. In addition, an aggregation method is applied to a third column. Every time we create a pivot table, we have to define which column to use to generate the row IDs, which column to use to generate the column headers, and which column to use to apply the aggregation method. The column age bin is the group column. This means the values in this column generate the row IDs in the pivot table. The gender column is the pivot column. This means the values in this column generate the column headers in the pivot table. Customer key is the column chosen for the aggregation, and the aggregation method is count. Notice that this aggregation method would give the same result with any other of the columns selected. Let's have a look at the pivoting node. The columns that we are interested in are the columns customer key, gender, and age bin. To create a pivot table like this, we first have to add a pivoting node to our workflow. Then, we open the configuration dialog of the pivoting node. Do you remember the three options we discussed? Group, pivot, and aggregate? Here you can see that for each option we have one tab. In the Groups tab, we define the row IDs in the pivot table. In our example, as we just saw, each value in the age bin column produces one row in the pivot table. Therefore, we include this column in group columns. In our example, the pivot table will have two columns, one for each gender. So, we include the column gender in pivot columns. Under the Include and Exclude fields in the Pivots tab, there's also an option that allows missing values to generate their own pivot column. This option adds a column with the total value, and this option ignores the data domain information. We've now defined the column headers and the row IDs of the pivot table. Next, we define the aggregation column and the aggregation method for the pivot table in the Manual Aggregation tab. Like the Group By node, there are many aggregation methods available, for example, count, mean, percent, and sum. If the meaning of some of the aggregation methods is not clear, they are all explained in the Description tab. In this example, we want to produce the number of customers for each gender and age bin. That is, we want to count the data rows in these groups. The aggregation method we want to apply is count, which just counts the rows. We select customer key as the aggregation column and count as the aggregation method. We chose customer key as the aggregation column, but note that counting the number of rows in each group would have produced the same numbers if applied to any other column. It is just a count of rows. It's independent from the column we apply to. It is independent as long as we do not exclude the missing values. If we disable this flag, then the data rows with missing values in this column are excluded from the count, and count numbers vary depending on the selected aggregation column. In addition, we can define some more advanced settings in the lower part of the configuration dialog. Using these two menus, we can define the column names of the pivot table. In the first menu, we select if we want to include the pivot column value and the aggregation method name, or only the pivot column value. In the second menu, we can select how the aggregation method name is written if it is included in the column names. If we check this option, the pivot columns are sorted in alphabetic order. In case we have a powerful enough machine, we can improve the performance by selecting process in memory. By selecting retain row order, the pivot table will have the same order of values as they appear in the input table. If the pivoting column has many distinct values, we can set the number of maximum unique values to be considered in order to avoid generating pivoting tables that are too big. Here we can select the value delimiter in case the selected aggregation method returns a string of concatenated values. Now we click OK and execute the pivoting node. We open the first output table, which is exactly the pivoting table we wanted. In addition to the pivot table, the node has two other output tables. One shows the group totals, that is, the totals by row. The third output table shows the pivot totals, that is, the totals by columns. Remember the option Append Overall Totals in the Pivots tab? Because we enabled it, this last cell contains the full number of input data rows we have processed. In this video, we have shown you how to build a pivot table that summarizes data using the pivoting node. We explained the elements of a pivot table, namely groups, pivots, aggregation method, and aggregation column, and showed how to make these settings in the configuration dialog of the pivoting node.